All right, good evening, everybody. It's good to see you out tonight in the house of the Lord. And this evening begins a five-week series, actually kind of six with Passover thrown in the middle, but a five-week series on answers to the questions you thought we forgot that you had texted in back in January in our Q&A Sunday. And we didn't get to about 250 of the questions that were texted in. So what we did was we categorized the questions into five major categories. And tonight's topic is the topic of heaven and hell. A lot of you had questions about heaven and hell, and so I'm going to do my best to try to tackle as many questions as possible without really, here's going to be the format. I'm not going to be looking at each question and answering it. I just kind of compiled all of the questions and then just arranged a general teaching tonight in hopes of just covering all of these various questions that you asked. Now, likely, I'm not going to get to every single nuance of the topics of heaven and hell, but I'm going to do my best to leave about 10 or 15 minutes in the teaching time so that you can text in additional questions that I may not have answered in the course of this first attempt. So here's how you can do it. Don't text now because I might answer it before, you know, you'd need to text it. But I'll put the number back up for you a little bit later, but you'll be able to text in your question to 62953 is the phone number. When you type your question, you have to start your question with the letters CC, skip a space, then type your question. And the phone number again is 62953. Now I'll put this number back up when we get to about the 10 minute marker with 15 or 10 minutes left, so that then you can text in any questions I possibly may not have answered in the course of tonight's teaching. But I'm looking forward to this series with you. It's always just as challenging for me as I prepare for it, and so I learn so much myself, and so I hope it'll be a good time for us together as we're just good students of God's Word related to some of these topics that are important to you. And I hope that the topic of heaven and the understanding of hell is important to you, because these are realities in the Bible. So we're going to talk about it tonight. Well, let's first have a word of prayer. Father, we just want to thank you for the opportunity to gather here in your house and to look into your word related to the topic of heaven and hell. And Lord, I just pray for your help tonight and that all things would be for your glory. And we thank you, Lord, for the hope that we have of heaven. And we pray that we would be equipped in our faith to understand a little more about heaven and to understand also the reality of hell. And so, Lord, help us tonight in our study through these topics. And we thank you and we praise you together in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. Well, I'm going to start out by asking you a question. Imagine there's no heaven.
Imagine there's no heaven.
It's easy if you try. No hell below us.
No hell below us.
Above us only sky, friends.
Above us only sky.
Imagine all the people.
Imagine all the people.
Just living for today.
Living for today.
Now, 1971, John Lennon wrote and performed that song. It was number 3 on the Billboard Top 100. Friends, when you come to Cornerstone, you get some goodies but oldies. And that song came to my mind because that's a song about wanting there to be no eternity beyond here and now. Imagine all the people just living for today. No hope of anything beyond this life. This is as good as it gets. You know, sometimes our wrong theology will be shaped often by reality. And I wonder what John Lennon thinks now. Because I don't know his heart, so I don't intend to judge the man at all, but he's experiencing life after death somewhere. The Bible speaks about heaven and hell as realities, and so we're going to approach it from that standpoint. Now, before I get asked the question, I'm just going to say right up front, there have been some books written about people who've had life after death experiences, 90 Minutes in Heaven, 23 Minutes in Hell, to name a couple of books, for example. And look, I'm not here to debate all of the points within those personal experiences, but I will say this, I don't want you to draw your understanding of heaven or hell from what people say that they may have experienced in their own personal lives. The authority for what we need to understand in regards to the topic of heaven and hell is really the authority of Scripture. And sometimes when you read books like 90 Minutes in Heaven or 23 Minutes in Hell, not everything necessarily lines up with Scripture. And so what I want to do with us is review the things that the Bible says. And so already I'll tell you, just, you know, for those of you who are here, maybe just you're curious, maybe a friend invited you, you don't really claim to have a relationship with God, and we're glad you're here. But I want you to know the vantage point I'm coming from right out of the gate is that Scripture, is that the Bible is the authority for the topics of heaven and hell. And it's not based on, and you know, I'm not putting down people who talk about their personal experiences. I can't validate it. And the only sure thing I know is what Scripture says in relation to the topics of heaven and hell. So what I intend to do tonight is, first, I'm going to look at the topics of heaven and hell. We're going to start with the topic of hell because I thought, let's finish on a high note. But we're going to start with hell, and then we're also going to talk about heaven, and we're going to talk about three things in particular. We're going to talk about intention, location, and description. Intention, what was the intention behind hell? What's the intention behind heaven? Where are they located, and how are they described in the Bible? So that's the direction we're going to go. And as I start into this topic, I'm reminded of some advice from Charles Spurgeon, the great 19th century British preacher, who said to his students, when you speak of heaven, he was trying to instruct them, when you get into the pulpit and you start teaching on these subjects, when you speak on the topic of heaven, let your face radiate with the glory of God. And when you speak on the topic of hell, just your regular face will do. So I'm gonna start out with just a regular face. And then I hope when we get to heaven, that topic, it'll be a little more radiant. But first, on the topic of hell. So we're going to look here at intention, location, and description. And I put some slides up here for you. I put some scripture verses for you. Hopefully I won't go too fast for you who might be taking notes. But first, let's talk about intention. What is the intention behind hell? And before I even specifically talk about the intention, I want to make this point clear from Scripture, and that's this, that God doesn't want anyone to go to hell. 2 Peter 3:9, which says he is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. And in addition, he takes no pleasure in the death of anyone, including the wicked. Ezekiel 18:32 says, "For I take no pleasure in the death of anyone, declares the sovereign Lord, repent and live." And Ezekiel 33:11 says, "As surely as I live, declares the sovereign Lord, I take no pleasure in the death of the wicked, but rather that they turn from their ways and live." I remember several years ago, I was at an event down on Capitol Hill the day that Osama bin Laden was killed. And ABC News is there, and I was at an event where it was, you know, Christian and pastors were there, and so they put a microphone in front of my face and a camera, and they're like, you know, what do you think as a Christian about the death of Osama bin Laden? The fact of the matter is, in my flesh, I was glad for his death. But when I consider God's heart, he does not take pleasure in the death even of the wicked, because God doesn't want anyone to be separated from him. So we should never, you know, celebrate the death of the wicked, because that's a grievous thing to God. It's grievous when people reject him, when people don't know him. and are separated from him eternally. So I want to start by saying that in relation to hell, we need to understand that God doesn't want anyone to go there, and that he takes no pleasure in the death of anyone, and particularly no pleasure in the death of the wicked. Well, then you might ask, why did he allow hell to even exist? So here's the short answer. Hell was originally intended for Satan and the angels who joined him in rebellion against God. This is what Matthew 25:41 says. Jesus says, he's teaching at the end of a parable, and he says, "And then he will say to those on his left, 'Depart from me, you who are cursed, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels.'" So you can see there that Jesus said the original design for hell was for Satan and his angels. You see, even before the book of Genesis, because we don't have all of the record related to the rebellion of Lucifer. We just know that he did. Jesus even said, "I saw Satan, Lucifer, fall like lightning from heaven," when God cast him out of heaven to earth. But what we do know, putting scripture together, is that at one point, Satan was the chief of the angels in heaven. He rebelled against God, and he led a rebellion with other angels in heaven. Revelation 12 implies it was a third of the angels. How many are a third of the angels? We don't even know how many that might number. But they rebelled with him. They were expelled from heaven. And it tells us here, Jesus tells us here in Matthew 25:41, that that was the original design and intent for hell. That God created hell as a place of judgment for Satan and the angels who rebelled with him. Now, what that means, though, for us is that those who join in Satan's rebellion against God by rejecting Jesus as Savior will likewise experience the same ultimate punishment. Now, Satan is not presently in hell, but that's why hell was created. Satan is on a leash. He's allowed still to roam the earth, along with his fallen angels, otherwise known as demons, but their ultimate place of judgment will be eternal torment in hell, which will then be cast into the lake of fire, where they will forever, perpetually be tormented. There's a misunderstanding about hell that some hold, and they think that it is annihilation. It's not annihilation. When those who are sentenced to hell, and they are sentenced to hell by virtue of their own denial of God, their own rebellion of God, they are perpetually tormented for that rebellion. It is not that you go to hell and you're just burned up and then you are no more. Annihilation is a false doctrine. By the way, even in the church, there's a false doctrine called universalism. And universalism basically teaches that God is so loving that in the end, nobody is really going to go to hell. And in fact, in universalism, which is a heretical doctrine, it is believed, therefore, that hell doesn't even really exist. Hell exists. The Bible speaks of it. Jesus refers to it more than he does to heaven. And we need to understand it as a place of judgment and a place where God doesn't want anyone to go. That's why he sent his son Jesus to die, to rescue people so that nobody should have to go there. But by our choice and rebellion to God, we could, in that sense, then join Satan's rebellion and likewise end up there. Now, in terms of its location, where is it located? And to piece together a few passages from the Bible, it seems that the place that hell is located is in the center of the earth. Now, I know that's going to disrupt some of you who are like, no, scientists tell us that, you know, the core of the earth is, and by the way, this is a variable. You read some scientists, they say 6,000 degrees Fahrenheit. Others say as much as 13,000 degrees Fahrenheit. No one has ever been there, friends, okay? No one has ever been to the center of the earth. I will tell you this, they might be on target in terms of it being hot. Because the Bible seems to indicate that that is where hell is located, in the center of the earth. It tells us in Scripture that after Jesus was crucified, his spirit descended to the lower earthly regions when he went to the paradise side of hell. That's Ephesians 4:9. And in Luke 23:43, he promised that one thief on the cross that he would be with him in paradise that day. But Ephesians 4 is clear about he descended into the lower earthly regions. And Jesus said he would be there 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth, Matthew 12:40, when he compared his soon-to-be crucifixion and death to that of Jonah. In Matthew 12:40, he said, "For as Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the belly of a huge fish, so the Son of Man will be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. So that seems to be where it is. You know, it's interesting. In the 1600s, the Puritans in America had this saying when they would greet each other and they would pass by each other. The first person would say, "Heaven is high," and the next person in response would say, "Hell is low." And today that's been abbreviated. We say hi and hello, but that actually came from the traditional Puritan greeting to remind each other, heaven is high, hell is low, hi and hello. Those common greetings today came from that Puritan greeting. So the Bible indicates that hell is beneath us. How far down? The very center of the earth? We don't know specifically, but it is beneath us. It is below us. Then in terms of its description, when we look into Scripture as to how hell is described, a few bullet points for you. One, that it indicates to us, I'm getting my notes all out of order here, so hold on, that it is a place of eternal fire, but it is non-illuminating and it is non-consuming. I'll explain that in a moment. But here's Matthew 25, 41. It says, "Then he will say to those on his left, 'Depart from me, you who are cursed, into the eternal fire, prepared for the devil and his angels.'" I quoted that verse a moment ago, but I want to emphasize the eternal fire part. Mark 9, 48, Jesus talks about hell as the place where the worm does not die and the fire is not quenched. So it's a place of perpetual eternal fire, but we know it is non-illuminating and we know that it is non-consuming because people are perpetually tormented and it's complete darkness in hell. So it's not illuminating kind of a fire. In Matthew 8, verse 12, it says, "But the subjects of the kingdom will be thrown outside," this is Jesus speaking, "into the darkness where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth." Now, I want you to try to imagine darkness. One time I went spelunking. How many of you have ever been spelunking? It's caving, right? That's a fancy word for it. You crawl in caves. And I remember going spelunking into this, we were down deep into the eternal caverns of, in Bath County, Virginia, just down deep. And it was the darkest darkness I had ever experienced. And one of the things I remember sensing at that moment was how isolated one feels when you are in complete, utter darkness. So what goes hand in hand with darkness is loneliness, because you feel completely isolated from others because you can't see them. It is outer darkness, Jesus describes it, and it is a place of torment and misery. Matthew 13, 42, "They will throw them into the fiery furnace where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth." Often in the Bible, that expression, weeping and gnashing of teeth, is used in relation to describing hell. Weeping and gnashing of teeth. There's a place of misery. It's a place of torment. It also tells us in Scripture that hell is a conscious, in hell you'll have a conscious, I hope none of you, but a person will have a conscious awareness that something is better but unattainable. There's this whole story in Luke 16, I won't read it, but it talks about how there was a rich man who, and it isn't because he was wealthy, but it just speaks about his idolatry and he didn't follow God, and he goes to the place of torment. And he cries out across this chasm to the place, what was called Abraham's side, and he begged Abraham, "Dip your finger in water and come over and quench my thirst in this torment." Abraham said, "No, I can't come to where you are." And he had this awareness, the one on the torment side had this awareness that there was something better, and but he couldn't attain it. So that's tormenting in itself. And then also the Bible says that in hell, one will have the realization of the separation from God's presence. In 2 Thessalonians 1, 8 and 9, it says that he will punish those who do not know God and do not obey the gospel of our Lord Jesus. They will be punished with everlasting destruction and shut out from the presence of the Lord and from the majesty of his power. It's interesting because in the Bible, it speaks about there's no place you cannot go that escapes the presence of God. He is omnipresent, but apparently he restricts his presence in some way in hell, because there in that verse I just read, they have no ability to be in his presence. It is separated in that sense. So, on to heaven. You ready for heaven now? All right. In terms of the intention and location and description of heaven, the intention of heaven is this. It is the habitation of God and the eternal home for those who have trusted Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. That is the purpose of heaven. It is presently occupied by God. He's on the throne. And those who know Jesus as Lord and Savior, when they die, their spirit separates from their body, and they go to be with the Lord in his presence in heaven. 1 Kings 8:30 says, hear the supplication of your servant and of your people Israel when they pray toward this place. Hear from heaven your dwelling place, Solomon says, and when you hear, forgive. So God's dwelling place is in heaven. Psalm 103:19. The Lord has established his throne in heaven, and his kingdom rules over all. And then when it speaks in the Bible about how we go to be in God's presence, Paul would write there in 2 Corinthians 5:6-8, he says, therefore, we are always confident and know that as long as we are at home in the body, presently on earth, we are away from the Lord. We live by faith, not by sight. We are confident, I say, and would prefer to be away from the body and at home with the Lord. So Paul writes there and says to us, when you know Christ as your Savior, to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. And since the Lord's presence, his dwelling place, is heaven, then it is pretty clear that one goes to be with the Lord in heaven when you die having known Christ as your Savior. Revelation 21:27 says, nothing impure will ever enter it, nor will anyone who does what is shameful or deceitful, but only those whose names are written in the Lamb's book of life. So that's the intention. God's intention of heaven is the place of his habitation and our eternal home for Christians when we die. Where is it located? Well, the location is somewhere above the earth beyond outer space. It's somewhere above beyond outer space. We know this because in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, Paul writes about this basically a near-death experience that he has, and he talks about being transported to what he calls in 2 Corinthians 12 the third heaven, the third heaven. And by that, what he means is the first heaven is the earth's atmosphere. So when we talk about the heavens, plural, by the way, the word heaven, singular, is used more than 600 times in the Bible. But then it's also used in a plural way, the heavens. And that's a generic term that speaks about, you know, things that are above. The first heaven is Earth's atmosphere. The second heaven is what we would call outer space. The third heaven is where God dwells, which is beyond outer space. So we get that from 2 Corinthians 12:1-2. And then also in Psalm 14:2, this is just one out of many examples where it says, the Lord looks down from heaven on the sons of men to see if there are any who understand, any who seek God. So it is up above, God looks down, and we ascend when we die. How about its description? The Bible talks about what heaven is like. Now, I will say this before I read these verses. There is a difference between heaven presently and what the Bible describes in Revelation as a new heaven and a new earth. Now, the Bible tells us that the present heavens and the present earth will be destroyed, and that there will be a new heaven and a new earth. And actually, what the Bible teaches is that the new heaven will come down to earth, and the new city of Jerusalem will actually be located on earth. It will literally be heaven on earth. So what I'm about to read for you from Revelation 21 is actually the description of the new heaven. So this may or may not actually be very descriptive of the present heaven, but I think it's pretty safe to say that the new heaven will be very similar to the present one, perhaps in a greater way, but this is what we can look forward to ultimately, if not currently. And so what we read from Revelation 21 is that there will be streets of gold. In fact, it talks about the heavenly city being all gold. It also speaks in Revelation 21 of it being strangely transparent. So it is something that is colorful yet transparent. And it does talk about how there will be gates of pearl. There are 12 gates. There are 3 gates on each of the 4 points of the compass, 12 gates in all. And the Bible says that each gate is a single pearl. That's a huge pearl. Try to wear that around your neck. And it talks about foundations of costly stones. And then it also tells us in Revelation 21 that heaven is illuminated by the presence of God. There is no need for sun. There is no moon. It is illuminated by the glory of God because of his presence. So let me just read a little bit about this from Revelation 21. This is verses 15 to 23. The angel who talked with me had a measuring rod of gold to measure the city, its gates and its walls. The city was laid out like a square as long as it was wide. He measured the city with the rod and found it to be 12,000 stadia in length and as wide and as high as it is long. He measured its wall and it was 144 cubits thick by man's measurement, which the angel was using. The wall was made of jasper and the city of pure gold, pure as glass. The foundations of the city walls were decorated with every kind of precious stone. The first foundation was jasper, the second sapphire, the third chalcedony, the fourth emerald, the fifth sardonyx, the sixth carnelian, the seventh chrysolite, the eighth beryl, the ninth topaz, the tenth chrysoprase, the 11th jacinth, and the 12th amethyst. The 12 gates were 12 pearls, each gate made of a single pearl. The great street of the city was of pure gold, like transparent glass. I did not see a temple in the city because the Lord God Almighty and the Lamb are its temple. The city does not need the sun or the moon to shine on it, for the glory of God gives it light, and the Lamb is its lamp. Beautiful description of heaven. I mean, I think that, you know, we only have an understanding of colors because we have three primary colors and out of that come all the rest on the color wheel. But what if there was one more color among primary colors that we don't even know? I mean, it opens up a vast array of additional colors. So I think it's just a spectacular sight to behold, beautiful beyond description. I think John is doing the best he can there in Revelation 21 to capture the main parts of what it looks like as God reveals it to him. But I think it's beautiful beyond description. A couple of more good bullet points about heaven. It's a place of no mores. It's a place of no mores. No more death or mourning or crying or pain. Revelation 21:4. That's good news, isn't it? No more crying, no more pain, no more death. By the way, this answers the question that some of you might have about, you know, what does my loved one know in heaven concerning things on earth? I think little to nothing. Because I can't imagine that someone in heaven can behold all of the terrible and grievous things that's going on earth and not be grieved or mourning about that. So because there's no grief, there's no mourning, there's no pain, there's no crying, I think those things are just kept from them. There's a whole interesting discussion about quantum physics and being outside of time and space, which God is, and thus time might be an immaterial thing where you know, it doesn't coincide with our existence on earth. That's a whole other discussion. So there may not be much for them to behold in terms of what would cause them mourning or grief anyway, because it's possible that when we die or when we're raptured, it's all this spontaneous thing that happens all at the same time, but for another discussion and for somebody much brighter than I on that. But it is also a place of reunion with loved ones and friends who knew Christ as Savior. This is a big question I often get. Will I know my loved one in heaven who also knows Christ? Will we recognize each other? And we will. Here's the reasons. Matthew 8:11, Jesus said, I say to you that many will come from the east and the west and will take their places at the feast with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven. Well, how will you know Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob when you get to heaven except that they will be recognizable? Well, if they're recognizable, then that means everyone else is recognizable. Even Jesus, when he appeared to his disciples in his glorified body, was recognizable. Well, the Bible says that when he appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. We get a glorified body in the same way Jesus got a glorified body, and that means that he was recognizable. Thus, our glorified body will also be recognizable. It will bear the same resemblance and likeness that we have now. I don't know if that'll cheer you up or depress you, but... but it'll be a nipped and tucked better version of you. And it'll be a glorified body, and so you'll be recognizable, and your loved ones will be recognizable as well. Also in Matthew 17, I put the verses up there, verses 3 and 4. This is the Mount of Transfiguration. Jesus goes up the Mount of Transfiguration. He takes Peter, James, and John. And behold, they recognize with Jesus Moses and Elijah. Well, Moses and Elijah were hundreds of years before Peter, James, and John. How did they recognize them except that it was revealed to them in some natural way where they knew who they were? And so thus will be recognized. And 1 Thessalonians 4:17 says, after that, we who are still alive and are left, talking about the rapture, will be caught up together with them, with the saints, and to meet the Lord in the air. And so we shall be with the Lord forever. So if we're caught up together, all of a sudden, do we now not know each other? The rapture certainly indicates we go together, so we'll know together. And thus we will be known, and we also will recognize our loved ones. So that's a basic coverage of heaven and hell in terms of intention, location, and description. What I want to do right now, I'm going to open up the texting now to you if I didn't answer some of your questions. But I want to, while you're doing that, if you have the need to text in, oh, actually, I need to get set up too myself. What I'm going to do is I'm going to specifically go after some of the other questions that you had previously texted in and answer those as well with just very quick answers. So give me a second here to get this all set up. Some of you have already been texting in. All right. Do believers face judgment by God when they go to heaven? No. Romans 8:1 says, there's therefore now no condemnation to them that are in Christ Jesus. The judgment you faced was already paid for on the cross. So as a Christian, you don't get up to heaven and now stand and face another judgment. And I had that guilt trip laid on me as a kid. I remember somebody, some pastor, somebody saying, when you get to heaven, they're going to have like this jumbotron screen, and they're going to replay everything you've ever done in your life. What? I mean, if that won't get you saved, I don't know what will. But I don't see jumbotron verse in a Bible. And so, look, that they're not going to replay those things. God forgets our sins as far as the east is from the west. He's not now going to revisit them when we get to heaven. What becomes of earthly relationships once in heaven with your wife, husband, parents, or children? So Jesus says in Luke 20, 34 to 36, that when we get to heaven, we're going to be just like the angels. And he's specific about it. He says, we will neither marry nor be given in marriage, and we will not die, which means that relationships will be different. All I can say is that everything is in heaven is going to be better then. It's just going to be different then. It'll be a better different. You, if you're married, you will not relate to your spouse the same way. Parents and children, look, we're all going to be brothers and sisters, and we are all the bride of Christ. And so all I can do when I put together the verses of Scripture is to come to this conclusion, that we're going to be so raptured with who Christ is and being in the presence of the Lord that our relationships with one another will just be that much better. And that you won't be, you know, sitting around and, you know, oh, I want, where's my wife? Where's my, and for others, you're just going to be like, oh, good, I don't see, you know, but hope that's not the case. But we're going to be all together as brothers and sisters. Somebody said, my mom passed recently. Does God allow her to be our guardian angel? And the answer is no. We don't we don't start out as angels and then come to earth. And when we die and go to heaven, we don't become angels. Angels are a different class of beings that God created before he created mankind. But people don't become angels. Someone says, do the people who did not accept Jesus in this life get another chance to go to heaven in a different judgment? The answer is no. You have one opportunity. That's this life that you've been given. How does someone during the Old Testament era go to heaven if Jesus wasn't sent until the New Testament era? That's a long answer. I would just direct you to the teaching library, Luke 16. Look up Luke 16. I did a teaching on Luke 16, and I go into detail about that. Basically, Old Testament saints were kept in paradise because they believed in God through the sacrifice of animals, but it wasn't sufficient to get them to heaven. Now, Jesus emptied paradise when he went there. Where did Jesus go during the 3 days that he had died? And his spirit went to the paradise side of hell where the saints, the Old Testament saints, were. He emptied paradise, though, because Ephesians 4 tells us that he led the captives free in the train of his robe and then escorted them to heaven because now the fulfillment of Messiah had come and the blood of Christ had been shed on the cross. But there is no limbo, and Old Testament saints have now been taken to heaven where they previously only had temporary provision for righteousness. Once Christ died, then they were able to put their trust in him because he appeared to them. But go to the teaching library, look up Luke 16. This is a sensitive question. Do young children go to heaven when they die? Some of you have lost, obviously, children. It's one of the most gut-wrenching things a person could possibly experience. And I don't say that from personal experience. I say that just from an outsider's view of watching the pain. But I've done funerals for little children and for babies. And here's the comfort for you. In 2 Samuel chapter 12, the baby born, the first child born to David and Bathsheba died. And David wept over the death of that child. And then praying that that child would get well, because it was sick, but it ended up dying. And then David got up, broke his fast, and he actually went to the house of the Lord and worshiped. It was a very interesting response, because he just basically, like, I got to run to the arms of the Lord during times like this. And some of you get that. But he said in 2 Samuel 12:23, he said, I will go to him, but he will not return to me. That is a huge theological statement there in 2 Samuel 12:23, because what David was saying was, I will see my child again, but he can't come back here. So he spoke about the promise of heaven. God makes gracious provision for children and for those who don't have the capacity or ability to make a decision for Christ. God makes gracious provision for them. I could go a lot longer and to build the argument why from Scripture, but from the overall message of Scripture is that God makes gracious provision for those who are too young. Now, what point is that age of accountability? I don't know. That's between a person and God. There's not a magic age for that. But at some point, someone is accountable themselves. But prior to that, when they can't make a decision, or maybe there's some mental disability, they're not ever able to make that decision, God makes gracious provision for them. And so take heart that you'll see your child again. And then of course, this great question, do pets go to heaven when they die? I'll be careful. In Genesis, it talks about when the animal kingdom was created. It's interesting, from the plant kingdom, then God creates the animal kingdom. This is before man. And when God creates the animal kingdom, it says that he creates them as living beings. And the Hebrew word there is nephesh. And it actually is the word soul. He creates animals with a soul. Now, don't get too ahead of me on this, okay? A soul means that one has the capacity to think and reason and have emotion. Human beings are also created with a soul, with nefesh, but we have one other aspect in the Hebrew. We have ruach, we have a spirit. The animal kingdom does not have a spirit. It is a higher level than the plant kingdom because, you know, your fern can't think, reason, or have emotion, but your dog can, and your cat. Nasty emotion, but your cat can. And so I wish I could say that, your pet would go to heaven, but I can't say that on the basis of Scripture. They obviously have emotion. They have, you know, feeling. They can think. They can reason. They have nefesh. They have a soul. I will say this, if it's any measure of hope for you whatsoever, that it, in the millennial kingdom, it does speak about animals. Isaiah talks about animals. And it does tell us in Revelation 19 that Jesus comes to earth on a white horse. So you horse lovers, yeah, we can, a horse is a horse, of course. And so perhaps there are animals, at least we know of a horse, but beyond that, I can't really say with certain authority. All right, let me get to a few questions because we have 10 minutes left. What is purgatory? So purgatory is, this is what someone just texted in. Purgatory is basically a Catholic doctrine that teaches that there's a holding tank. When a person dies, they go to like a holding tank, this place where they can be prayed out of And hopefully, if God honors the prayers of the living, that their deceased who has gone to purgatory could be rescued from purgatory and taken to heaven. But I'm sorry, that's just not in the Bible. And again, when we look at the Bible as the final word of authority, we don't see purgatory mentioned in Scripture. I know where purgatory comes from. It's the Luke 16 story. It's the idea that when Jesus, this rich guy went to the place of torment, and across the chasm was Lazarus, who was the righteous man, and Abraham. And so it looks like there's a holding tank, because prior to Christ's crucifixion on the cross, Old Testament saints did go to the place of paradise, which was one half of the side of hell. There was a torment place, and then there was paradise, the place of where the saints went. And so that got translated somehow into the idea of purgatory as a holding tank, but paradise is empty. Now the torment side of hell is still occupied. That will, Revelation 20 tells us, eventually the present hell will be thrown into the lake of fire. But presently people are on the torment side of hell, but there is no such thing as purgatory. What determines whether you get sent to heaven or hell? The answer to that is whether or not one has made a profession of faith in Jesus Christ. Look, the invitation to heaven is wide open to anyone. Okay? The invitation to heaven is wide open to anyone. But the ability to get there is dependent on one way. Now, I know for some, this is where they take issue with Christianity. They're like, well, this is you narrow-minded, bigoted Christians, because you only say there's one way. Jesus said, I'm the way, the truth, the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. All right? I settled years ago that I'm not flustered by the idea that there's one way, because I came to the realization that I'm thankful God made a way. And so I don't stumble over that anymore. Now our objective is to get as many people to come to understand Jesus so that they can enter the one way to get to heaven. Because the entry is narrow in terms of one way, Jesus, but the invitation is broad in terms of all people, right? Okay? Will we be able to remember our past mistakes in heaven? I hope not. No, I don't believe so, because I believe that God wipes away every tear, and so you'll be crying over things, I know I would be, that you've done in the past. So the Lord's going to remove all those kind of things from our memory, no doubt. He forgets as far as the east is from the west. Why would he allow us to remember? How old will we be in heaven? That's always a great question. It's unknown, but here's the best guess. The ancient rabbis believed that the universal age is 30. When you look into Scripture, a priest became a priest at the age of 30. Jesus' ministry began at the age of 30. How old was Adam when he was fashioned? He wasn't a baby. The rabbis believe he was 30 years of age. The Bible doesn't say, it's silent about it, but that seems to be a universal age. Even to this day, a strict Jew cannot read the book of Song of Solomon until he reaches the age of 30, because it's a little spicy. So it might be that we're all this universal age of 30. I don't think, like little toddlers who went to heaven are stuck at like 4. And I don't think you're hobbling around at 85, right? That wouldn't be a very fun heaven. So I think that we're this universal age 30. Again, this is kind of speculative, but it's kind of sewing together some ideas of Scripture. Now, to be the universal age of 30 is wonderful news for those of you who are presently over 30. For those of you who are like 17, bummer. But okay. Somebody asked, will we be angels in heaven? I answered that, no. There is a paradise side of hell. It's been emptied. That was in place before Jesus died on the cross, but now that he's died on the cross, we go directly to heaven. If hell is meant for Satan and the angels, but Satan is not there yet, then do people go there if they have rejected God? They do. The only reason why Satan is not there yet is because he has still been allowed to roam the earth. I know that sounds almost counterintuitive. Well, why doesn't God just bind him up and then there is no Satan? You know, look, part of what we have to understand theologically, even about the realization of the reality of heaven, is the reality of hell actually brings light to the reality of heaven. You know, look, I hate mosquitoes, all right? I hate mosquitoes. What purpose do they serve? You know, I don't like mosquitoes. But in reality, if you kill all the mosquitoes, it upsets the ecological system. And that mosquitoes are necessary for the rest of the ecological system of the earth. Otherwise, then you throw even the good stuff out of whack. So, you know, they say that we need all that stuff, even though it seems like it's unnecessary. You know, why should we have mosquitoes? So, you know, even the very thought of why hell at all, if you remove hell from the equation, you upset the balance of theology. Because again, it's like how can we understand evil if there's not good? How can we understand good if there's not evil? How can we really appreciate and understand heaven if there is no hell? So all of this becomes a great theological discussion. But Satan temporarily has been allowed to roam the earth. But when someone who rejects God dies now, they don't roam the earth like he does. If they reject God, if they have not received Christ as their Savior, then they will go to hell. I know that sounds like a horrible thing, and I would only say that and emphasize it in order to motivate us to bring as many people into the kingdom with us. This is an interesting question. Do you believe King Solomon is in heaven? Now, here's why people ask that, because Solomon sunk at a very low place in his life, and then he even introduced, not for the first time, but certainly to the height of it, idolatry and child sacrifice during the nation of Israel. I do think that Solomon is in heaven, and I think it's because of the way the book of Ecclesiastes ends, which we'll get to this Sunday. Can we go to heaven if you're not a Christian? No. And I know that, you know, the world likes to glamorize heaven as a place where everybody goes if you're a good person, but the Bible tells us otherwise. The Bible says there's none righteous, no, not one. The Bible says that none of us in ourselves are good. And this is where Christianity is different from all other world religions. All other world religions basically teach some aspect of striving to be a good person, and then that will gain you entrance into heaven or reincarnated or nirvana or some aspect of a better life. Christianity is the only world religion that says you can't earn your way there, and none of us deserves our way there, and none of us is good enough to get there. But there is one who was sent on our behalf because of that condition of our soul, not good enough, can't earn it, can't work our way there. And his name is Jesus, and by his sacrifice on the cross, when we trust in what Christ did, Christ satisfied the wrath of God. See, sin must be punished. If someone broke into your house and stole things from you, if the thief was caught, was apprehended, hauled before a judge, and the judge did nothing, you would be rightfully angry, because a righteous judge cannot allow something wrong to go unpunished. And so the truth is, all of us have done something wrong. None of us is perfect. You can at least agree with me on that. Everybody understands that. Well, I'm not perfect, but I know. Well, don't add the but part. None of us is perfect, and that's what makes us sinners. Because we're sinners, our sin must be judged, because God is a righteous judge. He can't allow sin to go unpunished, otherwise then he's not righteous. So he has to judge us. But what he determined to do was to offer his son Jesus as a sacrifice in our place. And what God determined to do, the Bible tells us, is I will put the punishment and the judgment intended for every single person, mine included, God says, I'm going to put that on my son Jesus. And if you will accept that and believe by faith that that's what I've done on behalf of mankind, For as many as believe me, to them that received me, I gave the right to become children of God. This is what God says to us in the Bible. If you believe in what Christ did for you on the cross, his perfect life, his sinless life as a substitution for us, he took the wrath of God, he took the judgment of God, he took the penalty that was intended for us. If you believe that, then you can have your sins forgiven. And in having your sins forgiven, then by putting your faith and trust, okay, I believe Jesus did that for me. I accept that. I wasn't there. It was 2,000 years ago, but I believe it by faith. Something in my heart bears witness to this. I believe it by faith. I accept Jesus into my heart. Then you can go to heaven when you die because your sins are forgiven. And the wrath intended, the judgment intended for you was placed on Jesus. You by faith accept that and believe that, then you're able to go to heaven, not for your own merit, or because you deserved it, or I deserved it, or we worked our way there, but because we put our trust in what Jesus did, and this is why Jesus said on the cross, it is finished, because you can't improve upon that. It's what Christ did for us to purchase us from sin and death. And so heaven awaits us, friends, for putting our faith and trust in Jesus Christ. Amen?
Amen.
All right, praise the Lord. So next Wednesday night, our topic is creation versus evolution. I'm going to have Dr. Lou Wing, Dr. Jill DeRoe with me. We'll do like a panel discussion. We'll be tackling your questions then as well. And I look forward to that night with you also. But first, let's pray and thank the Lord. Father, we do thank you for your word, the reminder of heaven, the reality of hell. And I pray, Lord, that for those who are here tonight or maybe someone's watching online and they texted in that question about how to go to heaven. I pray that all of us would settle that. That if anyone right now is just kind of on the fence and they don't really know if they have a relationship with you or not, that they would receive you by faith. They would trust you. That what you did on the cross was sufficient for them, so that they can have their sins forgiven and so that they can enjoy the eternal reward of heaven when they die. We know, Lord, that you tell us in your word, you want none to perish, but all to come to repentance. You do not take pleasure in the death of the wicked. You are heartbroken over those who reject you. You want none to go to hell. That's why you offered your son Jesus on a cross to rescue us. And so I pray right now, if there are those who don't know you in a personal way, that they would trust you tonight. That they would trust you tonight. That they would put their faith in you. Now I'm going to pause in my prayer just with your heads bowed, eyes closed, because I don't want to leave here tonight having talked about heaven and hell and not present you the invitation of how to go to heaven. So here's the deal. I'm going to offer this prayer. And if you want to pray to trust Jesus as your Savior so that you can know you go to heaven when you die, have your sins forgiven, then I want to invite you to pray this simple prayer with me right where you're seated. You can just whisper this to the Lord. You can repeat it after me. Whisper it to the Lord. Make it your prayer. Just join with me in this prayer. Let's do this together. Just join me. Just say, Lord Jesus, thank you for dying on a cross. Some of this is new to me. I'm not sure I understand it all. But I believe by faith that you paid the price for me on a cross. You took the punishment intended for me. You took the judgment that I deserve. And you died in my place. So tonight I surrender my life to you. I trust you, Jesus, as my Lord and Savior. Forgive me of all my sins. Come into my heart tonight, Lord. And I look forward to one day standing in your presence, completely forgiven and completely welcomed into heaven as my eternal home with you. Thank you, Jesus, for dying for me and for loving me. In your name I pray. Amen and amen.